Welcome to the teleconference session of PGDMC's program. Today we have two sessions. The first session will be from 10 a.m. to 10:45 a.m. and the second session will be from 11 a.m. to 11:45 a.m. In these two sessions, we will discuss about health management, which falls under MME 201, Block 6. In our previous teleconference, we had covered pediatric and obstetrician gyne topics. After this session, I'll take up some issues related to the common administrative problems in the program study centers. I want to just inform the students that we have just passed all the study materials. That is, there are three courses in practical, and all the three courses related to practical of pediatrics, obstetrics, gyne, and community medicine has been dispatched, and I hope you have all received the material. If there is some problem, you can ask during the teleconference and I'll be happy to reply them. Regarding the spell training, I hope second spell is already over throughout the country. There is some confusion regarding the third spell. Some centers have already conducted the third spell. However, we have instructed that the third spell can be conducted during the month of October and November. We are delaying your academic session by 6 months. So you will be allowed to appear in the final examination during June 2009. So the center who have not conducted the third spell, they can delay their spell and they can conduct during October or November. If there are any query about this, you can email me or you can have the questions right today and we will able to reply them. For today's session, in the first session, we will take up the topic basic concepts and principles of management. To discuss the topic, we have two experts with us. To my left, Dr. A.K. Anand. He is Associate Professor at All India Institute of Medical Sciences. He has been involved in the program development and also as an editor. To his left, Dr. A.K. Sood. He is Secretary General Executive Director at National Board of Examination. He has already been involved with us as a course writer, course editor, and also he is involved for teleconference sessions for past three batches. So I will request the students to utilize their expertise and they can clear all their doubts related to health management today. Now I will request Dr. Sood to tell us what is the need of training the doctors about the health management. Dr. Sood, please.
Thank you, Professor Jenna. In fact, all of us who have got our degree from medical colleges during MBBS or even during post-graduation, hardly anybody teaches us about management. And over the period of time, as we become senior, as we acquire more and more experience, and we are given administrative position as head of the department, head of the unit, or head of the institution, or we get an administrative position in a health services, we unknowingly apply some of these management concepts and principles. Usually we think that these management concepts and principles are for the industry sector, but let me tell you, these concepts and principles are universally applicable, whether we are working in health sector or engineering sector or in industry, or even in a household level also, we are using some of these basic concepts and principles, sometimes not even knowing about them. So I think it is important that if we know some of these basic concepts in little bit more detail and apply these principles and concepts in our day-to-day activities, whether we are working in a private clinic or we are having an administrative position in a medical college or a hospital or in health services, we'll realize that our performance will improve. So basically, these concepts and principles are applicable in all situations, irrespective to the specialty you are working in. But unfortunately, as I mentioned earlier, that nobody teaches us some of these principles and concepts during our curriculum at MBBS level or even at postgraduate level. And I'm really happy that the Indira Gandhi National Open University has started this management program for the doctors in the form of a health and hospital management program, and also management components are being covered in MCH and other programs. So I hope with these inputs, you will gradually realize that your performance as a clinician, as an administrator, is improving. Another important thing here to understand is that there are certain empirical evidence, there are certain studies also which have proved that if we acquire some of these management competency, the performance of the organization improves. And one of the important study has been done by Management Development Institute in Gurgaon, They have studied the public sector institution. Most often we say that the public sector institution can never earn a profit. And in these studies, they have found out that just by improving the management capabilities at the key position, the performance of these public sector units can be increased as much as 33 to 40%. So that itself shows how important it is for all of us to understand some of these management concepts and apply these concepts in our day-to-day activities. Now, broadly understanding the concept of management, I think we have three or four key elements which we should understand. As a manager, whether you are head of department, head of the unit, or maybe working as an administrator at the district level or the state level, you are dealing with certain inputs or resources. These inputs could be in terms of money. You have the budget allocated to you. It could be in terms of manpower. The manpower could be medical manpower, paramedical manpower, nursing professionals, so and so forth. It could be in terms of material and equipment which you are dealing for various, giving various services, or it could be other types of resources. So basically you are dealing with inputs or resources. Then you have a set of rules and procedures which are given by the organization in the form of rules and procedures, service rules and procedure. And there are certain processes whereby the inputs which you have are converted into the outputs. Let's take an example of a hospital setting. Your inputs available to you are medical doctors, there may be nursing professionals, then there are health workers if you're working at a primary health center, community health centers, then there are other type of support, secretarial staff. Then you have money, annual budget which is allotted, you have the equipment. Then you have certain rules and procedure whereby you convert these inputs into services outputs. It could be in terms of OPD cases which you examine. It could be in terms of surgical procedure you perform, or clinical procedure or investigation which you perform from a hospital or a unit. And then there are outcome of this procedure, whether now we are concerned with quality, for example. As a result of the inputs and the procedures and the output which has been coming out from your unit, what is the quality of that, whether the satisfaction, whether the complications are less, or the improvement or cure rate is high, like that. So basically you are dealing with inputs, basically you are dealing with some procedures, processes, you are dealing with certain types of indicator in terms of output, and then you have the outcome. So as a manager, your main task is to use these inputs in such a way that your output and outcomes are better. So your two concerns, one is efficiency, another concern of the manager is effectiveness. When we talk about efficiency, basically it is the output-input analysis. For a given amount of output, how much inputs you are using. If you are a better manager, if you are more efficient manager, that means you are giving more output per unit input. For example, number of the cases we are seeing in OPD, number of the indoor patients which are admitted in your ward, number of surgical procedures which are done in your ward per unit doctor or per unit, maybe cost you can also calculate. You can also calculate per unit, say investigation done per unit equipment, how many MRI scan done per unit MRI unit which you have. So like that, this is what we call as efficiency, that is output-input ratio. The second important concern for a manager is that not only you should give good amount of output, but the quality of the output should also be better. There should be patient satisfaction, there should be cure rate should be high, the complication rate should be less, and that you usually depict by the effectiveness, that is outcome input parameters. So basically these are the things which you should understand. And now we'd like to see what are the definitions of management. In fact, in management books you will find many definitions. And in fact, there is another term which is sometimes used synonymous, like management and administration. So many of you may be concerned that is there any difference between administration and management, or they are the same. So different management books give us different definitions, and some of the management books say that they are almost synonymous. Administration is a term which is usually used in the government sector, and whereas the management is a term which is used in the private sector. Otherwise, they say that basically the contents or definition they say are the same. There are other experts who feel that the management is much more broader term, and which also covers the administrative rules and procedures. On the other hand, there are other experts who feel that administration is usually concerned with the formulation of policy guideline, whereas the management is the term which is used exclusively for administrating those guidelines for giving different types of outputs. Now let's see some of the common definition which are available and which will be easy for us to understand. The one of the important basic content in the definition is that you must, and management basically is an art of getting the things done from others. So there are two key words in this particular definition. One, that it is an art. Art because you are dealing with the human beings also. Because as I mentioned earlier, as a manager, the inputs available to you are in terms of money, in terms of equipment, and also in terms of manpower. So out of these different types of inputs, manpower resources, manpower input is very, very important, because money and material and equipment is utilized through the manpower resource. And secondly, this manpower resource is a living resource. The way you deal with a living resource, it is definitely different than the way you deal with a non-living resource of material, equipment, money, and so on and so forth. So that's why some of the experts feel that management is an art, because you have to deal with the human resource. Through human resource, you are getting the things done and using the material equipment. So the way you deal with this human resource is an art, and this you gradually acquire with experience. And this is an art because you have to get the things done from others. If yourself you are doing a job, that does not mean that you are a good manager. The basic purpose of a good manager is that he has to get the things done from the other. That means if you have three people, four people working in your unit, or you are working in a dispensary, so it is your concern as a manager to see that all the subordinate staff which is working with you, they give their best. So these are the two important terms in the view of some of the expert in management, that it is an art which you learn through experience, and then secondly, it is the basic concept here is to get the things done from other.
Dr. Anand, would you like to interact here for differentiating between administration and management?
As Dr. Sood rightly said, we are never taught about management in our medical colleges, but invariably doctors always work as a team. Hardly ever doctors work as a solo player. They always work as a team and often lead the team. If not, they are at least junior leaders and gradually take up our leadership position. And if you want a team, and if you want to achieve something from a team, that is what a team always has a goal. Team wants to achieve something. And if you are a leader of that team, you want to achieve something, all you need is to use the resources which are available to you and achieve whatever objective you wanted to do. That process is known as management. How you use your own resources to achieve your objectives. It can be done intuitively, or that can be learned. It's a learned thing also. And the focus here is on how to make you learn certain basic principles which you can apply. Many of us apply it intuitively and instinctively in our daily life. It is no different whether you apply it in health, you apply it in your daily life, or in your school, college, wherever you are. Management principles remain the same. The difference between management administration, I think, is academic. I would say management is more about laying policies, laying guidelines, where administration is more about implementing them, more about seeing to it that you implement those guidelines. That would be, to me, be the main differentiation between an administrator and a manager.
Maybe Dr. Sood, you can summarize and highlight something more.
Dr. Anand has very rightly said, in a medical field, you have to work as a team. You may be a very good surgeon, but if your support staff, your other nursing and paramedical staff is not equally trained, your performance, your efficiency as a good surgeon also decreases. So this is very important to understand. In health sector, most of the time we are working as a team. And it is important that each and every member of the team is given opportunity to give his or her best, and he is given due importance. Many a times when you talk about training, you are concerned with, say, doctors only. But in a team, you have paramedical, you have even the ward attendant, class force employees in the hospital who have a very important role to play. So as a manager, you have a big challenge how to ensure that whatever objective you had here, Dr. Anand gave a concept of objectives also. This is very, very important in management. In fact, each unit, each department has certain objectives to be achieved. In fact, why this department is created, surgery department or medicine department or a hospital administration department created in a hospital setting, it has some objectives. So these objectives are to be fulfilled, and for that purpose, the manager is given resources. Resources could be in terms of different type of manpower, material, money, and equipment. And then there are set of guidelines, procedures, standing operating procedures and guidelines, rules, which are again given by the organization. So manager has to basically see how, keeping in mind the inputs and the procedure, he is able to achieve the organization or the departmental objectives in terms of outputs and outcome, which we have discussed. So when we say that a good manager or a good administrator in a particular department, that means within the resources, because resources are never infinite. Even if you go to the best developed country in the world, the resources will always be a constraint. I mean, the money will be a constraint, technical manpower will be a constraint, and again, money, material, equipment will be a constraint. So the best thing here is how you use those management capabilities and skills as a manager, and you use whatever resources you have, because you will see subsequently, in fact, in the government setup, if you look into the, you compare a government setup with a private and corporate setup, or government hospital with a private hospital, you will see that the government setup still has surplus resources, especially the manpower resource. We say that the manpower resource is the most difficult resource, most costly resource. If you look into in terms of recurrent budgets, 70 to 80% of the budget goes towards the salaries of the employees. And this manpower is hardly fully utilized. There are studies in the government setup from, especially, let's take the example of primary health centers, where the utilization rates for the primary health center is as low as 30-35%. So that means that in the government setup, we have plenty of resources, especially the human resources. There may not be latest equipment. The money may be available, but sometimes the rules and procedures are such that you are not able to use it as you want. There are certain constraints, but manpower resource is definitely there. And the main challenge for you as a manager is how to use that resource in terms of linking it with the objectives of the organization. So what we find, and another important question which rises in our mind, is why in government setup we are not able to utilize the full potential. And here one of the reasons here as I've given is that we have plenty of manpower resource, and maybe we don't have adequate skills to utilize that resource, because this resource is different, as I said, from non-living resource like material, equipment, and so on, because it has feelings and emotions. So, and this again is a unique strength with the human resource, that if you are able to sort of use these feelings and emotions in a positive way for your subordinate may work wonders. So one of the reasons which we find that in government setup, people are not, organization are not able to fulfill their full potential, is that they don't really get the full potential from their subordinate. And one of the important reasons is we never appreciate the good work done by our subordinates. And if there is some failure, we blame it to the subordinate. If there is some success, we claim for ourselves. So this small intervention, like appreciating your juniors, appreciating your subordinates, appreciating your colleagues, will make a big difference. That will motivate them, and that will encourage them to perform better. And many a time it happens that we don't accept a suggestion from our subordinate. Say, I am working as a primary health center medical officer. And in a monthly meeting, if a sub-center worker gives me some suggestion, usually I don't accept it that readily. I feel that I am much more superior in terms of knowledge, technical knowledge. But I forget that this particular worker, health worker, is working in the village level sub-center for 10, 20 years. I may be a good experience of a primary health center as a clinical or maybe as a manager, but this person has much more experience of working in a village in that particular scenario. So the type of problem he is facing and type of suggestion which he can give for overcoming the problem will be much more appropriate. So that should be, I think, encourage you whenever a subordinate gives you a suggestion, at least it should be given a due hearing, and the concept that boss is always right, I think, no longer is applicable in the modern management jargons. In fact, in several organizations, there are mechanisms whereby they encourage the suggestion by the what we call the line functionary or the peripheral functionary. Like, you must have learned about the quality control circle. This is the concept which has come from the Japanese management, where they give an opportunity for the people who are really working at the periphery. They have a mechanism that if they find they want to give some suggestion for a particular problem, they can directly interact with the higher level management in terms of giving some suggestion, putting their suggestion in the suggestion boxes, and those suggestions are given due importance and due consideration. And with these suggestions, they have found out, the Japanese management companies, they have found out, companies have found out, their performance has improved. So that is another, I think, area which as a government sector we have to look into, that boss is not always right, but the subordinates can give good suggestion, and that should be considered. Another important point which we find in government setup is that many a times when we are allotting work to our subordinates, we don't really consider what type of capability and skills they have. In the government setup in particular, many a time we find that the trained nurses, trained pharmacists, they are just given the task of registering a patient in the OPD or doing some paperwork, whereas they are trained person in terms of patient care. So when you are putting a person at a place where he or she is not able to utilize his or her skills which he has or she has acquired during a training, naturally his performance will not be better, and gradually the person will be demoralized. So many a times we find another reason for not performing best in government setup is that we are not really able to allocate work properly to the subordinate as per their interest, as per their skills, as per their strong points. And many a times, because as a manager, as a supervisor, it is your duty to see and monitor the work of the subordinate. It's a very important task of a supervisor to monitor the performance, to list out what are the strong points of the subordinate, and also to list out what are the weaknesses and deficiency. And not only pointing out these weaknesses and deficiency, which many times we do, we must also try to tell him how he or she can overcome those deficiency. And that will basically then result in the better performance. Just merely pointing out deficiency in front of other will not lead us anywhere unless we talk to the person, help him developing skills to overcome those deficiencies. So that is another reason that we don't really assist and guide our subordinates in improving themselves, in overcoming their deficiencies. Sometimes the reason could be that we are not able to communicate to them properly what we want. The communication is also very important, and we find that in the government setup sometimes subordinate and they hesitate to even talk to the superiors and not to say about telling their problem, genuine problem and suggestion. So that means the communication channel is also important. The way you handle this communication channel can make a big difference. And sometimes the managers, especially in the government sector, administrator in the government setup, they try to follow divide and rule policy. They try to sort of manipulate the things. They try to create a sense of mistrust in the organization so that they survive in the organization. So that again is not the right policy, because as Dr. Anand said in the very beginning, that in a team approach, the trust is very, very important. We must trust each other. We must respect each other. We must respect each other's position in the organization. There may be a person below you as a subordinate, maybe staff, nursing person, maybe other support staff, but that person deserves at least due respect as per his or her competency. So that's, I think, again, approach, manipulative approach should be avoided. Otherwise, it will result in productive activities, and that may not increase the efficiency and effectiveness. Another important factor which we find in government setup is that too much time usually we spend on paperwork. And this is a bureaucratic system which we have inherited from the Britishers. And many government organizations still stick to that. For small works, there's so much paper for works and formalities, so that much time and energy of the staff is wasted on that. And that again should be avoided. And many a time we find that there is no proper systems in the government setup. Like many of us don't know what our job profile is. When you join a service, when you join a position in a unit or organization, there should be proper documentation of your tasks. The task should be clearly specified, what is expected from you. Then what is your role and responsibility? Because just giving the task, you must know what is your role in the organization, what are your responsibilities. There should be proper standard operating procedure for, especially in the health sector when you are working in a hospital. What are the procedure when a patient comes in emergency with chest pain, for example? Then what are the standing procedure for a particular type of investigation or maybe clinical or surgical procedure? And if you define these procedures clearly, then you will find that you are able to utilize the resources properly. Otherwise, there may be wastages, there may be misappropriation. And again, when the people are not really clear about their role and responsibility, then they are likely to make errors also. So I feel that in government setup, if some of these things, which are very simple, even if you are working as at a dispensary level, or maybe as a unit in charge in a hospital or head of department, all these things you can do at your own level. Of course, there may be certain constraints in terms of changing the policies, but at least within those policies itself, themselves, there is a definite scope for using some of these methodologies which will improve your efficiency as a manager. So I feel that these are the reason why in the government setup we are not able to utilize our best, because we, as a manager, as a head of the unit or a department, sometimes we tend to ignore this deliberately or unknowingly.
Dr. Sood, you have nicely summarized that what are the deficiencies in the government setup and why work efficiency is so low. Can you tell us what is the duty of the or the skills that a manager should have? So that we know that how this would be handled.
Yes, this again is very important, because if we really want to be a good manager, at least we should know what we should try to develop. And for that, let me tell you, you need not acquire a management qualification. Because these, as we have discussed earlier also, that management concepts and principles are universal applicable. And most of us, without even getting management training, we are applying those things. So these skills basically are, again, very simple. Most of you may be having those skills, but once you are sensitized, maybe you will be more careful when you are developing those skills or using those skills. First and the foremost is, especially in the health sector, when you are working as a professional, your technical skills are very important, because we have seen the definition of management is to get the things done from other. So if you want that your subordinate should respect you, they should listen to you, you must have good technical skill. This is very, very important. Say if you are working as a surgeon and you want your junior consultant to perform better, so naturally you should update your technical knowledge. That is also important. And not only technical knowledge, but because you are to get the things done from other, you should also know the weaknesses of your subordinate, what are their strengths, how to motivate them. So a good manager will not only have a technical knowledge, but he will also have good knowledge about his subordinates. Many a times we are not really aware of what are the competencies or qualities of our subordinates. And this usually results because we only interact with them formally. And in the formal interaction, say when you approach your director or head of the department, usually the formal interaction is very, very, very limited. As a subordinate, you yes, no, or you your question, your answers are very, very limited. And during those formal interaction, you are not able to really learn about the competencies of your subordinate. So in order to know your subordinate well, you must have informal interaction. And when we talk about this informal interaction, that does not mean even routine small things. For example, you can have a cup of tea during tea break together. So if all your subordinate, 5, 6 junior consultant or doctor, if they come to a coffee room and have small discussion, you will learn informally. Because when you are informal, then you're more free. And when you interact more freely, you learn about each other. Your subordinate will know about you. At the same time, you will also know about the qualities of your subordinate. Another way could be that you may have, say, common, say, picnics, for example. Once in a year, you have a common picnics, or maybe go for sightseeing, may have outings. That, again, is an informal interaction, and you will realize a person has very good communication skill, for example. Or he's very, very, very good organizing skill. So why not to use that person for organizing some camp, immunization camp or family planning camp or maybe IEC camp. So these informal interactions are very, very important, whereby you will know the qualities of your subordinate. Usually there are three things which we want to learn. What is the capacity of the person? What is the capacity of the subordinate? That you will learn from his qualification. Like capacity is to maximum extent you can ask a person to perform a technical task. If you are dealing with a MBBS doctor, you in your mind you make up, okay, up to this level this person can do. If you are dealing with a person who has a medicine, MD in medicine, for example, then again, if the person is MCI, so basic qualification will tell you about the capacity of the person to the maximum extent the person capacity can be explored. Second is the competency. Competency you learn from the previous work experience. So from the biodata you can find, okay, this person has worked at a district hospital, or this person has worked in emergency department, this person has worked in other unit. So that way you know how much competent. Capacity means what the person can maximally do. And whether competency will tell you whether those qualities which he has, whether he has ever used or not, that you know by the biodata. And third thing is the capability, that how this person will suit your organization. So these are the three things which you should know about your subordinate: his capacity, his competency, capacity from the basic qualification, competency from his work experience, and capability, how best this person can be placed in your organization. I give you the example of trained staff nurses given the role of putting, maintaining records. So that means you're not using the capability of the person. So this is the way, the technical skill, I said, you must know thoroughly about your job. If you're a clinician, if you're a surgeon, if you're a medical person, you must know thoroughly about your area. Only then the subordinate will listen and respect you. Second important skill which you should have is communication and human relation skills. This again, 60 to 70% of the time of as a manager, as a head of department, you will find that you are spending in communication, attending meeting or talking to your subordinate or sending reports like that. So this again is important, because we have seen that of the various inputs you have as a manager, human resource is a very, very important input available to you. Not only because it is living, other resources can only be utilized through this human resource. So if you don't have good communication skills and good human relation skill, again, you will not be able to get the best out of your subordinate. And these skills can be acquired, as I said, learning about your subordinate, learning about how to motivate them. Because in this setting, sometimes if you take care of some of the small personal needs of the employee, or maybe their family needs or their social needs, they're also very important. You find that in some of the good companies, they take care of the, say, schooling for the children of the employee. They give, they open schools, they open colleges, they have health clubs. Like in CGA, government setup also, you give the medical care facilities to them or to their parents or dependent like that. So basically the purpose is to build a positive relationship, because the employee will give his or her best only when he thinks that the organization cares for them. Otherwise they will not. Unfortunately, this feeling is not there in the government setup. We usually think that the government institution is different and we are different. This is Sarkari. But unlike in Japan, give you a small case example of a Japanese management, Japanese companies. Still, the in Japanese good companies, they, when the employee come in the morning, they pray. They pray that their performance, their output, their production should be more than what it was yesterday. Because they link the performance of the organization with their welfare. They feel that if the production will be more, they will get more bonus. So because they, since they have a sense of belonging to that organization, they tend to give their best. Whereas in our setup, in the government setup, we don't have this feeling of belongingness. We don't really consider the hospital, the organization where we are working as our own. As a result, we don't give our best. And one of the reasons perhaps is that we are not able to develop good human relations or communication with our subordinates. So they are alienated from the organization, or maybe certain rules and procedures are so rigid that the employee feels that beside giving his best, he has not got the enough justice. And third important skill which you should have as a manager is the conceptual skills. Because Professor Anand said about the objectives. Ultimately, whatever your job you are performing, it has to be linked with the organization goals or the unit goal or objectives. And for that, you require conceptual skills. Conceptual skills basically is to foresee events, to foresee competition, to foresee alternative, impact of the alternative. So basically, if you don't have these conceptual skills, you will not be able to plan, you will not be able to have alternative strategies to meet the goals and objectives. So as a manager, you require technical skills that I've told you in terms of your particular area, specialization, but also you must have skill, knowledge about the skills of your subordinate so that you can utilize their potential. Second, we have learned that human relation and communication skills are very, very crucial. And third are the conceptual skills. As you go higher in the management ladder, the conceptual skill become more and more important. If you're working at a first level, for example, a primary health center supervisor, for example. So at that level, technical skills and communication skills are very, very important. Conceptual skills are required, but that may not be that much important. But once you become the director of health services, at that level, you have to plan for the entire state. You have to conceptualize the things. You have to anticipate the thing for future. So at that level, conceptual skills become more important. But that does not mean that you don't require human relations skill. Of course, their technical skill at that level may not be that much important. So usually we divide the management into three levels, first level, second level, and third level. Or we can call it top management, mid-level management, and line management. So at line management, technical skills are very, very important. And as you go higher at the top level, your conceptual skills are very important. But the three skills are required in different proportion. That there is no doubt about that. So this is in brief what type of skills the managers should have if you want to be a good manager.
Maybe I can request Dr. Anand to, he has already summarized more or less. If you can give in a different version.
Dr. Sood in the last 10 minutes talked about two main things. Number one, why often management fails. He took the example of the government system to highlight the areas where the management has failed. And secondly, he talked about what are the type of skills that is available. I will just organize his thing in a different way. Why systems fail, whether it is government or private, it can happen in both the sectors. Again, you look at management in three ways. One is the input, the output, and then the process in between. If there is a problem in input, and he discussed a lot about the, especially the human, when we say that often in the government sector, we have square pegs in round holes. Because of the various recruitment procedures, often the resources are inadequate because either the manpower is not there or funds are not there, equipments are not there or inappropriately there. And consumables again are very erratically available. So these are the main inputs, and if you don't have them in at right time, at right place, right amount, these things will happen. Then he talked about the process in which mainly we focus on very rigid and bureaucratic procedures which do not allow you to have flexibility which is often required while you are implementing programs, and a lack of a policy of quality control in most of the procedures. These two were the main thing which are hampering the process of delivery. And finally, is at the output level, the main problem lies with our monitoring and evaluation. There is not much accountability and not much monitoring and evaluation which is occurring. At all the three levels, if you don't do your job well, then obviously the system is not going to perform well. Looking at the skills, he rightly emphasized the technical skills. After all, we all are going to be doctors, and unless you are a good doctor, you cannot be a good manager. You will never gain that respect, and you have to lead, and that is the foremost thing for a leader. You have to inspire, you have to lead. You have to be good in what you are supposed to be doing. Then there are other softer skills, which we talked of, communication skills and how to maintain relationships. And also we looked at resources. Again, the focus was more on human resources, but remember time is also, we also discussed about time, but how time is wasted. Time management is extremely important for a manager. He can lead it by an example, by being punctual, by maintaining to the time, and by in different ways putting time-related parameters in monitoring this thing. The other thing which is, a manager has to be firm and decisive. You cannot be a good manager without being very firm. Often you may have to take decisions which are not pleasant, but you have to have that courage to take those kind of a decisions and stick by them. When I say stick by them, sometimes one has to also be flexible. So at the same time, leave room open for being flexible, being changing your decision. Dogmatic way of management will not take you for a long anywhere. And ultimately, manage your team well, which is in terms of delegation of power, and division of role of your team members, and those kind of things. And finally, monitoring and evaluation. Ultimately, we have an objective. We have to be clear. We have to monitor objectively every time, certain period, whether we are going in the right direction or the right space. If not, we have to change our strategy. And this is a continuous process which goes on happening till you achieve your objective.
I think it is told in two versions, and I think the students must have realized that how important the management is. And as a team leader in a primary health setup or wherever you are working, even as a private practitioner, the skill as a manager is very important so that you can maintain your institution and it will also prosper. Okay, Dr. Sood, can we now highlight few basic concepts in management and maybe some theories related to management so that the students can perceive it better?
Okay, I will skip the functions of management which are given in the module, and all of you are aware that is planning, organizing, staffing, directing, coordinating, reporting, budgeting, innovation, and so on, because that is very simple. And again, these are again universal, applicable in all setup, whether you are working at the district level or a dispensary level or a directed level, state level or central level. You do planning, do perform all these functions which are there in this. Now let's see how some of these concept of management have come over the year. One of the important concept of management is division of labor. And this concept was given by Adam Smith in as early as 1776. The basic concept behind this management concept is that you split the complex task into simpler units. And when you split a complex task into simpler unit, and the simpler units are given to different people to work, the performance will improve. So that is one of the basic concept which originated as early as 1776, that if you divide, that is known the concept of division of labor. That means if you divide the complex task into simpler tasks, the output will be more. And that is very easily understandable, that once you are splitting a complex task into simpler tasks, and the individual persons are doing those simpler tasks repeatedly, then gradually you learn to perform that particular simpler task, and then your performance also improves. Second important concept was given by Taylor, who was pioneer in analyzing the human work, because all of us now understand that each of us have a vast potential. If I ask you, if you are working as a dispensary or a hospital, how much you feel that you are potentially being utilized in the present setup? Maybe none of you will say 100%. Most of us will say 10%, 20%, or at the most 50%. So that means 50% of your potential is not utilized in the present setup. So this concept of human concept to work was given by Taylor. And he gave the concept that the human productivity can be increased indefinitely. So that again was a very big concept at that time, that when you are saying that people don't want to work, he gave another concept that if you have properly motivated people, if you have selected the people properly with the adequate skill, because many a time if I don't have a skill, I don't perform that task. But if I'm a good surgeon in a particular, I'm doing a particular type of GI surgery, I know it well, I will enjoy performing that task. So the basic premise behind this particular concept was that if you select the people properly and then you place them in a place in the organization where they are able to utilize their skill, and also because once you utilize those skills, you also develop yourself, and that gives you a sense of professional satisfaction. So that concept was given by Taylor, which mentioned that if you select the people properly, if you train them, if you place them properly in the organization where they utilize their potential, and also give them tools and means whereby they can use those skills, then productivity can be increased. So this was again at that time a new concept in the industry, that human resource is the most crucial one. Then we have another expert, Henry Foyle, and he focused on the problem of the top management. Earlier, if you look into the history of management, the factories were owned by the businessmen, and they were the people who were also occupying the key position as far as the planning and management was concerned. But gradually it was realized that you require professional people, professional manager to man those key positions, because the owner may not be adequate once you are having expansion of the unit, once you are having so much competition in the market. So that concept was given by Henry Foyle, and he focused that for the top management position, you require trained manager, trained professional. It is a professional management will improve the performance of the factory. And he also gave the concept that the management concepts and principles are universally applicable to all specialties and disciplines. And then again, he gave the concept of what we call as an organization structure and functioning. That was also an important concept. Many of you are aware that in an Indian, whether you're working in a hospital unit, you have the unit in charge, you have the senior doctor, you have the junior doctor, then you have the other support. So there is always a hierarchy in the organization. And this is usually predicted in the form of organization chart. So it may be just one page write-up, but it indicates so many things. And by planning this organization chart in a proper way, performance can be increased substantially. And that was the concept given by the Henry Foyle. And he also emphasized that once you are employing people in the organization, define their roles, responsibility, tasks very, very clearly. If I, as an employee, I am clear about what is expected from me, what is my responsibility, how much I am accountable, only then I will be able to perform. Say, if I am not really aware what is expected from me, I may be good in a particular area, but that ultimately may not be the objective of my unit, or may not be the objective of the organization. So these concepts, some of these simple concepts were given by Foyle. Then there is another important concept, which was the authority structure in the organization, which was given by the Max Weber. And he mentioned that by nature, people tend to obey orders from the higher authority, and this concept of authority structure. When you say about authority structure, when you go to meet your head of department, for example, so invariably you are positively motivated to obey his or her orders unless you feel they are contradictory. So most of the time we are self-motivated to obey because of this authority structure, which is always there in the organization. Then another social dimension to this management was given by Alton Mau. Alton Mau said that human being is also a social animal. That he gave that concept also, that sometimes we tend to perform well when we feel that we will be given credit among our peer group, for example. When our fellows consider that we are doing a very important job, so that itself, without any other incentive, that feeling itself improves the performance. And he added the concept of social factors in the management, and he focused on the human relation, communication, especially the informal communication which we have discussed. And he said that, and he proved through experiments, that if we take care of some of these dimensions, like social dimension, and improve the formal, informal and interpersonal communication, the things will improve. Then there are certain theories which have been evolved. The traditional theory, which was, as I said, from the industry in the very beginning, it considered man more like a machine, and as you deal with the machine, you have to deal with the man. That was a wrong concept, that if you want the people to work, give them incentive or give them strong disincentive, that is carrot and stick policy, which in subsequently was proved to be not a proper theory. Then theory Y is a humanistic approach. It says that all of us want to work as a human being. Work is satisfying to us psychologically, physiologically, and socially. And so this theory again gives a lot of emphasis on a humanistic approach, and some of these concepts we have already discussed. I think we are short of time.
Dr. Sood, we have now end of the session. I think we'll take up the session to the next session, that is from 11 a.m. Please be with us. We'll have a break now for 15 minutes, and we'll continue where we left.